This is Liberty Law Talk, part of Liberty Fund's online library of law and liberty. Your host is Liberty Fund fellow Richard Reinsch. Our web address is libertylawsite.org, where you can subscribe, comment, find other episodes and links related to today's conversation. Our email address is lal@libertyfund.org. Today we are discussing with Professor Jean Yarbrough her new book, Theodore Roosevelt and the American Political Tradition. Professor Yarbrough is the Gary M. Pindy Senior Professor of Social Sciences and Professor of Government and Legal Studies at Bowdoin College. She's the author of American Virtues, Thomas Jefferson on the Character of a Free People, and most recently edited The Essential Jefferson. Professor Yarbrough, glad to have you.
Oh, it's great to be here. Good morning.
So you've written a book that explores the political thought of Theodore Roosevelt in depth and also his statesmanship. You write at length in the opening of the book about the biographies and scholarship of a certain kind that he wrote about Gouverneur Morris and Thomas Hart Benton, as well as his multi-volume, The Winning of the West. I want to just get from you a sense of, so he writes these as a younger man, one of them even as a student, both an undergraduate and then a law student at Columbia. So he seems to have read deeply. And so how does this open an avenue for students of Theodore Roosevelt like yourself to understand who he was and what his mind was on a lot of different, you know, political questions, questions of civilization and progress, law, et cetera?
Well, it's a great question, and I'd like to start out by saying that I think it's really important to look at his formative educational years. Roosevelt went to Harvard in 1876. Now, those of us who are historically minded will realize instantly that that's the year of the centennial of the Declaration of Independence and of the Revolutionary War. And yet the event went largely unnoticed at Harvard. At Harvard, people really weren't interested in the principles of the Declaration of Independence. So much had happened intellectually. You now have an emphasis, and this is what Roosevelt picked up at Harvard, an emphasis on progress, an emphasis on history, and these are the organizing themes of the histories that he himself wrote. When he was an undergraduate, and I always point this out to my students, he had only one required history course at Harvard, and it was a study of Anglo-American constitutional history. Strangely, it began with a study of the Aryan race in pre-Socratic Greece and traced the development of the various tribes within the Aryan race, especially the Teutonic Anglo-Saxon branch of that tribe. And so Roosevelt thought much more in terms of these sweeping categories of race, rather than of the individualism of the Declaration of Independence. And when he wrote his histories, he never really referred to the principles of the Declaration. What he did was to say, we need to judge these various races according to their stages of development. Were they savages? Were they barbarians? Or were they civilized? And we couldn't really expect the American frontiersmen to act in a civilized fashion with respect to the Indians or the Mexicans or the French or any of the people with whom we came into conflict. And so this is a general movement in the 19th century, but what he did was to substitute nature as a standard for judging, nature, natural rights, natural law, substitute for those moral principles, a principle of history, development, and evolutionary development.
It was interesting, and I don't want to draw a facile comparison, and maybe this is just more humorous. I was thinking of William Buckley's first book, which has stood the test of time, God and Man at Yale. Of course, that's, you know, the book is Yale has rejected free market economics in favor of socialist economics, and it's rejected the idea that Christianity or Jewish Christian thought has anything to contribute or as a part of American civilization. Yet I keep thinking of God and Man at Harvard for Theodore Roosevelt as I was reading your book, particularly this idea just of the race, of the Teutonic germ theory, the social Darwinism, and this becomes a way to understand the progress of history. You know, even with the settlers, which you were talking about, you know, so we have largely Scotch-Irish settlers pushing into the Southwest, and yet he right. relates them back. I mean, so pervasive is the race. I mean, they would have been cut off from the Anglo-Saxon heritage of liberty he keeps talking about. They have
right.
their own.
He turns Celts into Anglo-Saxon.
It's so pervasive in his thought. It's incredible.
Yes, but and it's also very confused, and in a way, that's what saves Roosevelt. I mean, he's not a racialist thinker. He uses the term race in such a sloppy manner. He uses it to talk about the English-speaking race, in other words, as a language, where it's essentially race understood in terms of language. He talks about the American race in contradistinction to the English race. He talks about the Kentucky race, the Cherokee race. There are it's a sloppy designation, and what I fault him for is less his sloppiness. In fact, I think, as I said, it saves him, but rather that he does also in these books make invidious comparisons among the races, so that some races are weaker, they deserve to be annihilated, and there's a kind of triumphalist character to it, the spread of the white races, which he links up with the destiny of race expansion, which becomes, in Roosevelt, not truly awful, but you have a defense of imperialism given in racial terms, even though he mostly talks about it as expansion. So race is something that is in my view, mars his historical treatments. In my view, the most interesting of them is Oliver Cromwell, because in there he's forced to meditate on the way in which a leader of a free people, a great general and leader, becomes a despot. And he criticizes Cromwell because he says he didn't really respect constitutionalism. He didn't have a theory that would cabin his use of executive power. And in some way, Roosevelt himself, you could criticize Roosevelt later when he developed his stewardship theory of power for failing to do exactly what he accuses Cromwell of failing to do, which is to have a theory of executive power that is somehow constrained by constitutionalism.
Interesting as well. So we get an indication of what liberty is going to mean for Theodore Roosevelt, I think, from the Scotch. I mean, that was something I found very interesting in your book, in that liberty isn't going to be predicated on justice or a principle of right, but on the power of a people to claim it. I mean, that seems to be one way to read his thought on the settlers pushing forward. So it's your power to claim it and make it real. And that seems to be even part of the American story for Roosevelt, is this virility and strength of the people pushing forward. And of course, as you write it, in some measure, about how much he differs even from Washington and other key founders with respect to the Indians, and that nobility or noblesse oblige to the Indians, and their obviously weakened material position relative to the settlers, is not acknowledged by Roosevelt. It's inevitable that they will be pushed aside by the settlers. I thought, to me, that was quite powerful.
I would like to just, yes, you're absolutely right. I do emphasize those themes, and I'd like to go back and sort of just situate your comments. I think one of the things that distinguishes, there are two things that distinguish my book from other treatments of Theodore Roosevelt. The first is that my book focuses on his political thought. Most biographers focus on his life, and why not? It makes a great story. It would make a great movie. Whereas it's much thought is much less interesting, and so biographers don't focus on it. And the other is that I have tried to use the political thought of the framers, and the framers whom Roosevelt himself professed admiration for over and over and over again. George Washington, Alexander Hamilton, John Marshall, the Federalist. He said, gave speeches in the 1890s. Read the Federalist, he kept telling young college men, graduates, when he met and spoke before their political clubs. And yet it's not clear to me that he ever read them. So although he kept invoking the names of these people, I don't think he had really come to grips with their thought. That was certainly the case with George Washington. What he liked about Washington and admired was Washington's maxim that to prepare for peace, to pursue peace, one must prepare for war. In other words, military preparedness. But Washington's policy with respect to the Indians was one of magnanimity, benevolence, justice, generosity, pity for a race that, tribes of human beings who were about to be displaced, and Roosevelt saw none of that. His was much more triumphalist. Alexander Hamilton was another of the framers he admired, but again, I don't think that he really came to grips with Hamilton's arguments in the Federalist Papers for executive power or in the Pacificus Papers, where he expanded on his understanding of executive power. And although these are very broad conceptions of executive power, they are in some way cabined by a commitment to the principles of free government, whereas and to constitutionalism, where I think that in Roosevelt's case, it does become whatever the people want, I am empowered to do. And so he takes his bearings more from consulting the will of the people, which of course he assumes is progressive, consulting the will of the people and regarding the Constitution more as an obstacle to be surmounted. And then, of course, Lincoln. Lincoln was his beau ideal. He read and reread Lincoln during his presidency, and he was very fond of quoting Lincoln's speeches on the relationship of labor and capital. And I got really curious about that, and so I went back and I looked carefully at those speeches. And it's quite clear that Lincoln holds a view of private property which is based on the inalienable rights of individuals to the property that they have earned through their own labor. It's a Lockean framers conception of the natural right of the individual to property. And this was certainly increasingly not Roosevelt's view. Mm-hmm. Roosevelt uses Lincoln's words to defend the redistribution of wealth rather than to encourage people to use their talents in order to amass their own wealth. And when Lincoln was president, he was, of course, president during the Civil War, and he was forced by necessity to expand the scope of presidential powers. And, of course, as Locke warns, the most godlike princes are the ones who produce the most dangerous precedents, and this is the case with Lincoln. And Roosevelt looks at Lincoln, and when he's faced with the anthracite coal strike in 1902, right after he's ascended to the presidency after McKinley's assassination, he says, "This is an emergency. This is the equivalent. It is almost as if we are in a civil war, because all the people of New England will be without coal and they will be rioting in the streets, and this will lead to mayhem. And so I have to seize the coal mines if necessary and run them for the good of the people. And so here you have the first instance, even before he's formulated his conception of the stewardship theory of power, you see the way in which he reads Lincoln just as a grant of power to do whatever is necessary.
Let me ask you a question. Do you think he reads Lincoln, has Lincoln already, has he become associated in Roosevelt's mind and or the popular mind at that point, with just a pervasive equality? That this is what Lincoln now means. That's kind of one of the criticisms, that's kind of, there's something embryonic in Lincoln's statesmanship about equality becoming unbound.
No, I don't think so. I think here it is just, it's a justification for the exercise of manly executive power. And when he finally gets around to describing the stewardship theory in his autobiography in 1913, so a decade later, he's out of office, and he does connect it with a manly disposition. People, there are certain executives who do not flinch from responsibility, from taking responsibility, and they can do whatever is necessary as long as it isn't strictly forbidden, explicitly forbidden, to act on behalf of the good of the people. And of course, he dismisses William Howard Taft as one of those people who was just too weak to do what needed to be done. But what I argue in my book is that this takes us way beyond the realm of the presidency of Abraham Lincoln, whom he thought he was following. I don't think the redistribution comes as early in his presidency. It doesn't really come until the end of the presidency, and certainly in 1910 in his great New Nationalism address at Ottawa, Osawatomie.
I want to back up for a minute and consider something you said about Theodore Roosevelt and the Constitution. So you write at length about this notion of inherent powers, which you've kind of touched on, that he has. Sounds similar to Alexander Hamilton's notion of implied powers. Of course, as you correctly point out, implied powers for Hamilton meant you're tying it to an enumerated power, but you're considering the full scope of the grant of power to the government and what that might mean overall. Theodore Roosevelt, his notion of inherent powers is you are just kind of inventing things that you think the situation or the moment calls for. And you have an interesting quote. Theodore Roosevelt is actually being questioned on this, and he responds in the following way, quote, "The people are not made for the Constitution. The Constitution is made for the people," which you also note in connection with that, he clearly dismisses the idea of tyranny of the majority. He's not concerned about a majority trampling on rights or limiting.
Especially
or
property rights.
Overwhelming. And so we've got all of that going on, and then we can combine that with the stewardship theory as well. So this is clearly someone, as you say, who's just moved beyond the written Constitution and the limits and the structural ideas that inform it.
Yeah, the interesting thing is that he only once, as far as I know, ever floated the idea of inherent powers, and this was in 1906, and it was in Pennsylvania. So he used the founder, James Wilson, who was a Pennsylvanian, and mm-hmm. on the Supreme Court, member of the Pennsylvania Ratifying Convention, and one of our strongest nationalists. And Wilson had developed a theory of inherent powers under the Articles of Confederation. And this is the doctrine that that Roosevelt is applying to his own presidency, and arguing that if the states are incompetent or unable to address national problems, then the national government. So here, the doctrine of inherent powers does not locate these inherent powers in the executive branch. It simply is a general claim that the federal government somewhere, probably the president, but not specifically said to be so, has inherent powers. Interestingly, the following year, the Supreme Court rejects the notion of inherent powers in one of its rulings. And so that then leads, I argue that that's probably one of the part of the impetus for developing the stewardship theory of power, because the doctrine of inherent powers, as Roosevelt understood it, was really pretty confused.
That's interesting with the stewardship theory. Now, you write also about Theodore Roosevelt as the governor of New York, and he is always trying for balance, balance capital, balance labor, opposing forces, try and keep everyone at peace. I guess what I found interesting about that is he doesn't seem to be working from a level of principled compromise. In any way, it seems he just wants to make everything work. And so in a way, I guess I kind of thought maybe I was wrong with this. He's really open to any number of arrangements, just as long as some sort of peace, quote unquote, ensues from it. The stewardship theory, of course, moves beyond that and seems to be tied up with kind of progressive notions of the president as national representative, as embodying the people, as responsible for national uplift, et cetera. And so, and this kind of relates to how he sees himself in a particular, as you've mentioned, the great coal strike of 1902. Of course, what's interesting there as well, as you point out, he issues a veiled threat to property owners, to these owners of coal mines, that he is going to seize their coal mines unless they resolve this strike quickly with labor. And that's, of course, a very chilling move by the president. And if he had done that, the precedent set for our country would have been horrible.
Well, Truman tried to do it.
Yes, I was thinking about that as I'm reading your book. Yeah, yeah. But even there, I mean, Truman had a stronger claim, war.
Yes.
All Roosevelt had was some parochial political claims, but then also, you know, maybe you could say larger concern, as he tries to say there were public considerations in this private dispute, but that's a stretch.
Well, the anthracite coal strike is so interesting because all that Roosevelt really did was call the leaders of the labor movement and the coal operators to Washington and try to mediate a strike, an end to the strike. And if you look at stewardship in that respect, that he was doing something, nowhere in Article 2 does it say that the president shall mediate labor disputes. He was expanding on presidential power, but that's not what's really controversial, or at least it didn't seem controversial to me. What really seemed controversial was that if that had failed, and it did in the event, it succeeded, but had it failed, he was prepared to seize the coal mines. And so I just tried to point that out, and he uses Lincoln in the Civil War as the only precedent that he can come up with for it. And I try to play that out and look at what that means. But to go back to the question of balance, one of the things that I was struck by, Roosevelt, when asked in 1903 by an old classmate of his at Columbia, what he had been reading, said that he had been reading and rereading Lincoln, but he'd also been reading parts of Aristotle's Politics. And I was struck how, as governor and in the early years of his presidency, he kept trying to moderate what we would call the forces of oligarchy and the forces of democracy. Since I teach Aristotle's Politics every year, I was really struck by how much Roosevelt seemed to be moving in the direction of an Aristotelian polity in which you try to balance these two conflicting claims to justice. But what happens is that although Roosevelt continues to use the language of balance, it works for him. It's a great organizing theme. In effect, he abandons the notion of balance and very much puts his thumb on the scale of working on behalf of the laboring man and against the interests of the wealthy in society. So there's that big change. Mm-hmm. He keeps talking about balance, but the balance has clearly shifted, and now he's by 1906, 1907, he's coming down squarely on the side of the people and the demands of the people.
So what do you think pushes him in this direction? Are these personal experiences he's having as president? Are these powerful political forces that are pushing him this way? Is there an intellectual transformation? What's going on?
Well, I think in part, and it was interesting when I was writing the last chapter of my book, it was just 100, I was writing it in 2010, and there were the midterm elections, and in 1906 there were midterm elections, and the country was clearly moving in a left direction. The insurgents in the Republican Party were gaining steam, the Democrats were gaining steam, and Roosevelt just thought if he wanted to be the leader of these forces, he had to shift his politics too. I also think it was the company he kept. He ran around more with progressive reformers, and he gradually became more and more drawn into their orbit. What I argue in the last chapter of my book, and I think this cuts against the grain of what most historians have concluded, is that Roosevelt was powerfully influenced by Herbert Croly's Promise of American Life, which was published in 1909, and he read it sometime after he stepped down from the presidency and was on his African safari and making his whirlwind tour of the European capitals. And I argue that historians have said that Croly was really more influenced by T.R. than T.R. by Croly. But what I've tried to say is that what Croly supplied were the arguments for T.R. You don't go looking to Croly for policies. It's true, Roosevelt came up with the policies, but it was Croly who gave him the rhetoric and the arguments for encroaching on individual private property rights. And I think that becomes much clearer. It's already clear by the end of his presidency, but he doesn't have arguments. He's beginning to move in the direction of you can have wealth, but wealth has to provide a service or a benefit to the nation.
Yeah, there's that very memorable quote there.
From the New Nationalism speech. But he then, and that then led me to the whole question of, well, what is a benefit to the nation? Does he mean that the wealthy establish philanthropic institutions? Do they set up universities, as Rockefeller did? Do they establish research medical facilities? Do they set up libraries, museums, charitable foundations? What do they do? Does any of this constitute service? And I think Roosevelt's answer is no. The only thing that constitutes service to the nation is that you are helping to redistribute the wealth of the nation. And because he says that even if you provide a benefit, if you're overpaid, you don't deserve it. So President Obama's "You Didn't Build That" really has its roots in Theodore Roosevelt's New Nationalism. And it's not accidental, I think, that President Obama went to Osawatomie to make his famous pronouncement to gear up for his reelection.
Yeah, I mean, the progressive theory, which, you know, you didn't build that business. Yeah, going back to the idea, social justice actually requires everything is really in common. I mean, the state has to possess a rather awesome power to make it fair and equitable and in the service of everyone for it to work. I mean, and once you start to articulate limits to the to state power, then this is something the state really can't overcome to achieve those ends, or it, you know, makes it.
And I think this is the downside of Roosevelt's emphasis upon character. When I first read Roosevelt many years ago, I was struck by his concern for the character of Americans, because I'd written a book on Jefferson and Jefferson and character. And so I was drawn to him. But what you also see is that if you have men of character, and you attract, and one of the things that Roosevelt did was to make politics attractive for a whole generation of well-born, well-bred, well-educated Americans, and to lure them into public service so that it wasn't such a grubby profession. But the other side of it is that you were pretty much supposed to defer to these idealists, these men with lofty ideals, and remove the brakes so that they could set about reforming the country. And in that sense, overleap all of the institutional checks and balances. So character becomes an enabler of the stewardship theory of government.
So Roosevelt's known also for his role in the national parks and for starting the conservation movement. Political ideas informing that, of course, are tremendous. You write this as well, that Roosevelt is actually reconceiving something that hasn't been done in America, and that is man and his relationship to the state. Property, as we've talked about, has to be in the service of an overall national good. But of course, to achieve that requires tremendous power. And the relationship to the environment, the rights are also being reconceived.
Conservation was really a very interesting topic for me to explore in the book, because in some ways we should go back to some of Roosevelt's policies. For instance, Roosevelt did not think that natural resources should be locked away and just held in their pristine state. His whole theory of conservation was that they should be used, but they should be used intelligently. So I find that to be...
So it's not preservation. It's not preservation the way we see with current environmentalists.
Yeah. Conservation is the exploitation and sensible development of America's resources. Where I find Roosevelt to be lacking is that he really doesn't think that any private entrepreneur can responsibly manage the, America's resources. Basically, this is something that really only the federal government can do. And here you have this sense that these lofty, high-minded men can come in and they will manage resources better. And so he's just outraged to find that 20% of the nation's timber is in the hands of three lumber companies. This is just not acceptable. So he doesn't see that there is a role for private property in conservation. He doesn't think that private entrepreneurs will act in enlightened self-interest or with enlightened self-interest. Only the government can really do that. And so that I think is the downside of his conservation. He also conceived of it as a moral movement, and what I try to argue in here, he goes from the conservation of natural resources to the conservation of human resources, and everything is then folded into conservation. It can be labor regulations. It becomes a protean category. For the state to organize and reorganize, as he himself writes in his autobiography, the whole standpoint of the people toward the proper aim of government, toward the relation of property to the citizen, and the relation of property to the government were brought out first by this conservation work. So you see conservation, the whole conservation movement, as a way of getting a handle on the relationship of private property, the individual, and the state. And of course, that comes out in, I just came back from the West, and in these land grabs where the federal government just places whole millions of acres of forest land in reserves and takes it out of the state's control. And so it was very contentious, even in Roosevelt's day.
So the conservation ideas, or at least a substantial part of his conservation ideas, actually becomes a way into Roosevelt's overall theory of regulation.
Yes, and the theory, we should certainly, I think, spend a few minutes with Roosevelt's theories about regulation during his presidency and afterward, if I can just move on to that theme for a moment. We think of Roosevelt as a trust buster, and early in his presidency, he did want to revive the Sherman Antitrust Act. But once he succeeded in enlarging the powers of the federal government to exercise antitrust powers, he basically, for the most part, he abandoned that approach. And what he favored instead was ongoing regulation. He called it supervision. It sounds so benign. And from the earliest months of his presidency, he was pressing Congress to establish a new government agency. It was called the Bureau of Corporations, or it eventually, when it was established, was called the Bureau of Corporations. It did not outlive Roosevelt's presidency. It was finally, it was replaced by the FTC in the Wilson administration. Well, it lasted a little bit in Taft's. But what Roosevelt wanted to do, so we don't really spend much time thinking about it. And again, it was another one of those areas that I was curious about. And I was able to find some work that had been done on the legislative history of the Bureau of Corporations, because once Roosevelt got it established, he kept pushing to give it more and more and more power. And after he had gotten control of the railroads, what he said at the end of his presidency was that he wanted to make the Interstate Commerce Commission's control of the railroads the pattern for what the Bureau of Corporations would do for the entire industrial economy. And what he imagined was a much more top-down, heavily regulated government interference with the economy. And what I argue in there is that he moves well beyond anything that the framers imagined, or James Madison in Federalist 10, where he talks about the importance of regulation, government regulation, the regulation of these various and interfering interests forms the principal task of modern legislation. Madison writes, or competing interests forms the principal task of modern legislation. And what he really wants to do is not regulate, but to control the economy. And it is a very statist. It's much more statist even than Woodrow Wilson, which I think was a great discovery on my part. And I flesh this out in some detail in the book.
I mean, that's interesting because you think about an inept comparison. Railroads are public carriers. In American law, for obvious reasons, one can see a case for a closer regulation of them, particularly at the time. And then, but extrapolating from that, that now a more pervasive system of regulation for all manner of businesses is clearly, it's a weak comparison. So there has to be something ideological going on. There has to be some sort of belief that you need the superintending power of government because private interests on their own don't produce any sort of spontaneous order or anything that's good. It has to be directed.
Well, even the Federalists didn't think that the spontaneous order would be productive of all that was good. That was why you needed some regulation. But the point, I mean, for instance, you have to regulate fraud. You have to make sure that people are providing enough information. These things just don't happen.
Even within that system, there's a notion that you have this sort of a basic regulatory system. You have fraud. I mean, that's common law, but. Something. I mean, private interests are going to intermesh without a lot of interference.
That's absolutely right. And what Roosevelt is moving toward, and he's not alone. There's a whole school of economic thought out there that the age of competition is over, and what you have now is an age of cooperation. And this will be cooperation between labor and business and government. And government will be the mediating party at the table. So it is a much more statist system that he's moving toward. Even by the time he leaves the White House, this again was surprising to me that in 1909 he published two essays laying out where he and his Republican progressive followers could and could not work with the socialists. And what he meant by socialists were really the Marxists, those who were committed to the violent overthrow of the capitalist system, the abolition of private property. He was not in favor of class warfare, and he was not in favor of the abolition of private property, but he was in favor of the state-sponsored redistribution of private property and much more state control over the economy. He somehow thought he could hit the sweet spot between government regulation and yet still have entrepreneurs exercising their initiative and their energy so that the economy would continue to be productive. He thought he had, there's balance coming back in this dimension of his post-presidential thought.
There's also the, the conceit of knowledge, I think, in forming that as well, that somehow there will be a way to collect enough information about what's going on in the economy, about prices, about data, transport, et cetera, that would allow this sort of system of regulation to work seamlessly and to make it better.
Absolutely.
To make it better
right.
than what the people who are participating
right.
in it know. Yeah.
That government regulators, disinterested experts will be able to aggregate the millions of data points and achieve a perfect synchronization of the economy much better than free market forces with some direction would be able to do themselves.
Which obviously seems to live on under current conditions.
Well, it has grown, that's what I think is so interesting. We've certainly moved well beyond Roosevelt, but it's all there in Roosevelt. So that really the Republican Party in its older manifestation, or at least this wing of the Republican Party, bears significant responsibility for the progressivism of the 20th century because it all started with Roosevelt.
That's interesting. Well, Jean, this has been great. I really appreciate your time and talking with us about your book. The title of the book is Theodore Roosevelt and the American Political Tradition. Jean Yarbrough is the author. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
This is your host, Richard Reinsch, and you have been listening to a podcast that can be found at libertylawsite.org, where you can subscribe, comment, and find other episodes and links related to today's conversation. Our email address is lal@libertyfund.org.